good morning. I'm really thankful to be here. And I have loved spending some time thinking about gratitude and things we're grateful for. I loved last week listening to Carrie talk about the rhythms of remembrance and just making it a habit of looking for places where we see God and where we see where he's shown up and where we see his goodness to us. I want to start this morning with a quote. I'm going to reference Ann Voskamp a lot today. She literally wrote the book on gratitude. It's called A Thousand Gifts, and it's so good. It goes back to what Carrie talked about, of being in the rhythm of remembrance, of getting in the habit of making a list and remembering where God has shown up and where he is faithful. But she talks about gratitude, and she says, gratitude is at the center of a life of faith. It sounds too simple to be true, but isn't that the sign of all deep truth? So simple, we're tempted to dismiss it, and so hard, it is exactly what God uses to change our lives. So we're talking about eternal perspective with gratitude today, and really, I can sum it up in one word, it's the gospel. That is what eternal perspective with gratitude is. The more I study it and the more convinced I am that gratitude is the key to joy. It's the key to understanding and accepting grace. It's the key to this life, and it's the key to living with eternity in mind. So what is an eternal perspective? It's living with that greater purpose. It's choosing to believe that today is an investment in eternity. Goes back to the pay me now or pay me later. We are living for something beyond where we are right now. It's believing that we're under the care of a sovereign, loving Father with the big picture in mind and finding rest and comfort and gratitude in that truth. And we know this as moms. We say it to our kids all the time, like, just trust me. We understand it when we want them to eat healthy. We understand it when we want them to take naps. We understand it when we stop them from running across the street or sticking something in an electrical socket. We get it, that there is a bigger picture in mind. And we forget that sometimes with God, that just trusting in him can lead to gratitude. So how do we do that? We're going to look at Hebrews 12, 1 and 2 twice today, and we're going to start on verse 2 first. It says, therefore, since we're surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. We look to Jesus. Some versions say we fix our eyes on Jesus. If you think about Peter, when he got out of the boat to walk on water, as long as his eyes were on Jesus, he was fine. But as soon as he took his eyes off of Jesus, he began to sink. What we look at is important. Luke 11:34 says your eye is the lamp of your body. And when your eye is healthy, your whole body is full of light. But when it is bad, your body is full of darkness. So here is a little bit of a longer story from Ann Voskamp. She got up one morning, put on her glasses, and they broke. And we all have those moments where there's this little thing that happens, and all of a sudden you have this deep philosophical, theological, just epiphany because something like your glasses broke. And here's what she said. The bridge to joy breaks, and the whole world blurs when we lose our lens of gratitude. It's a complicated, unjust, profoundly heartbreaking world. And it's also true that when we don't have enough of the right focus, the world never seems right enough. When we don't give thanks enough, nothing in the world seems like enough. What we have right now, where we are right now, our whole world right now, never seems to be enough when the way we are seeing things is out of focus. This is painfully true. There are deep wrongs in the world and in our world, and all kinds of ache that desperately needs righted, but it's also true that without a lens of gratitude, everything looks like lack. Every screen we turn to, every road we turn down, keeps saying that we don't have enough, that we need more, we need to buy more, we need to have more, we need to be more. But the bridge to joy actually holds when we can whisper, thanks more. Giving thanks is what gives us back our vision. "We ought to give thanks for all," is what C.S. Lewis wrote. "If it is good, because it's good. If bad, because it works in us patience, humility, and the hope of our eternal country." Which means we can give thanks in all because everything is already good, or God is working it all into good. Our lens, our vision, our perspective, it's important. But that kind of feels vague. It's like that song we sang when we were little, "Be careful, little eyes, what you see." How do we know what to see? How do we know where to look? And that's where we look to Jesus and we look at Jesus. Because he is the author, he is the founder, and he is the perfecter of our faith. He did it, and he did it perfectly. Luke 22:19 says, "In the face of the cross, he broke the bread and he gave thanks." So he took the bread, he gave thanks, and said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." He did this knowing what was next. He knew what was next. He was going to the cross immediately after this, and he knew that was coming. But his eternal perspective, or like Hebrews said, for the joy set before him, he could endure it, and he could find thanks and gratitude and joy knowing what it was about to be. So how do we mimic Jesus? We remember him. We accept his grace. We embrace that we're not enough. We're honest about the truth of our sin and what we deserve. Ephesians 2:8-9 says, "For grace you've been saved, not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, lest any man should boast." The word "give thanks" in that Luke verse of Jesus, I'm going to say it wrong, is eucharistio. It's a Greek word. And smack dab in the middle of it is the word charis, which is grace. When we accept the gift of grace, it produces gratitude. It's a realization that I can't do it. I can't make it to heaven. I can't get to heaven. I can't be good enough. I'll never be good enough, ever. And I need Jesus. If we live like we don't need Jesus and we don't need grace, we live one of two ways. We live legalistically, and we think it all depends on us. Or we live hedonistically, like it doesn't matter, because we don't need grace and we don't need Jesus. It becomes entitlement. It's about what I think I deserve. And we've talked over and over again, I know in this series, that the opposite of gratitude is entitlement. So our final Ann Voskamp quote. Eucharistio means to give thanks, and give is a verb, something that we do. God calls me to do thanks, to give the thanks away. That thanksgiving might literally become thanks living, that our lives become the very blessings we have received. I am blessed. I can bless. Imagine I could let him make me the gift. I could be the joy. I love that. Let him make me the gift. If we go back to Hebrews and we look at the very first part of that, it says we're surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, and so we can lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely and run with endurance. The other way we fix our eyes on Jesus, the other way we find gratitude, is we surround ourselves with a great cloud of witnesses, like you are doing by being in a Bible study right now. We can find gratitude because we have people to help us find it. We can find grace because we have people to help us find it. We help other people see Jesus. Think about a beautiful sunrise, beautiful sunset, the beach, the mountains, your kids dressed up all cute. We take pictures and we want people to see it because we want to show people beautiful things. We want to show people Jesus too and become a part of that great cloud of witnesses. So what blurs our eternal vision? Think worldly metrics. When we start looking to the world to define what's good, what makes us enough, what is right, if we think, if I just had that house, if I just had that car, if we could just go on that vacation, that can blur our gratitude. We forget to be grateful for what God has given us. Suffering that can blur our vision because we don't want it, even though Jesus says to expect it. And then comparison, which has been called the thief of joy. And comparison can work one of two ways. You can compare yourself to someone and feel a lack of gratitude for what you have based on what they have, or you can compare yourself to someone and have a lack of grace because you think you've figured it out and you're better than them. A couple of things I do want to point out. What gratitude is not. Gratitude is not griefless. Jesus wept knowing he was going to raise Lazarus. Jesus begged the Father to take the cup from him, even though he had just given thanks and was fully willing and able and ready and went on to go to the cross. Hebrews says, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame. Gratitude is not perspectiveless. It doesn't mean you aren't honest about what's going on in your life. It doesn't mean you look for all the little silver linings. Those are good. But gratitude is trusting that sovereign God, that Father, that good, good Father, for what he's given you and what's to come and what's coming way further down the line. It's not a fake happiness, and it's not inauthentic. It's not Southern charm. Gratitude comes from a place of knowing who we are, knowing who God is, knowing what we deserve, and being grateful for his grace and his provision, even in the middle of the gross. And there are times we find silver linings, and those are great, but there are just days where we're grateful to sit with a friend and hurt, or to get to be the one that sits with a friend when they hurt. Gratitude is knowing he's our comfort and our peace and being thankful for him in the middle of that. That's as much an overflow of gratitude as when we sit around the table at Thanksgiving and we list all of the things we're thankful for. That's a great thing too. But gratitude comes in every situation and in every emotion. What are some of the eternal benefits of gratitude? Joy. The chance to experience heaven on earth. And the overflow that your gratitude brings to someone else. It's that ability to have the peace that passes all understanding, the thing that makes people wonder what's different about you, that cloud of witnesses, that thing that just makes you stand out. When we fix our eyes on Jesus, earthly things fade away, our perspective clears, our joys grow, our grief has context, our goals change, our whys change. I think sometimes we forget we're not supposed to be comfortable on earth, that it's not our home, that we're not meant to fit in here, that we were created for eternity and for something else, for something more. I love Psalms 137:4 says, we're called to sing the Lord's song in a foreign land. 1 John 2:15 through 17 says, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh and the desires of the eyes and the pride of life is not from the Father, but it is from the world. And the world is passing away along with its desires. But whoever does the will of God abides forever. Eternal perspective. What we're doing here today only matters if it matters in eternity. I love Ecclesiastes. It's like a little bit cryptic. It doesn't always make sense, but it feels very deep. I just love it. It's poetic. It's wordy. I love words. And I love Ecclesiastes 3. It starts with like the time for joy, a time for suffering, a time for war, a time for peace, all of those. But then in Ecclesiastes 3, 11 through 14, it says, he has made everything beautiful in its time. Also, he has put eternity into man's heart, yet so he cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. I perceive that there is nothing better for them than to be joyful and to do good as long as they live. Also, that everyone should eat and drink and take pleasure in all his toil. This is God's gift to man. I perceive that whatever God does endures forever. Nothing can be added to it or anything taken from it. God has done it so that people fear before him. He's made us for eternity. And like Job says, the Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. When we remember that this is not our home, that we were made for more, that we have a loving Father who gives good gifts. It doesn't make it easy, but it makes it easier. It doesn't make it painless, but it gives the pain purpose. It gives the joy more joy. And it helps us to just, like I talked about a few weeks ago, we can hold things a little more loosely and we can give things away a little more easily when we realize that we are not made for this world, but we're made to worship God and to give thanks to God and to accept and relish and find joy in his grace. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for your grace. Lord, if nothing else today, I pray that your willingness to come when you owed us nothing, when we had everything in the garden and we gave it up for just one more thing, and you loved us anyway and sent Jesus, Lord, that would just sit with us. God, that if someone doesn't know you, they would hear what you were willing to give up for us. Thank you for your grace. Thank you that it covers our sins and that it gives us joy. Lord, help us to look for eternity. Help us to find our gratitude and our joy in you. And thank you for a chance to be surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses in Bible study and in community, to point to you, to find you, to see you. We love you so much. In Jesus' name, amen.